Hello everyone, here PSST Dot One. It's been a while, I know that, since February. So, I'm glad, finally, to introduce you, Matthew Regan, that I had the opportunity to interview him last summer during the Touch Designer Summit in Montreal. He is the teacher of an entire generation of Touch Designer users. He started his career in a performance acting dance school, until he reached in 2015 after a beautiful academic path to work for Obscura Digital. But he will talk more about it. So, enjoy! How did you start with this world of data, visual, and visualization?
Oh my goodness. So I started with this work in grad school, I guess. I was an actor, dancer, circus performer, designer before I went to grad school, and I was wrestling with what do I want to do in life and how do I make a living and like have health insurance and have a place to live. And so I was thinking about MFA programs that were all performance based and other options. And I think it was that year that I saw the behind the scenes for the Amon Tobin tour. And it was projection mapping and video and real-time rendering. I thought, that's what I want to do. So I founded an interdisciplinary digital media arts and performance program in Arizona that was a combination of traditional live performance and new media technology. And so I started doing that. And then all of a sudden I was learning processing and Isadora and Quartz Composer. And I was trying to figure out what tool I wanted to use. And that's when someone said, oh, you should learn Touch Designer. And then I started learning Touch Designer, and there was, I don't think Elbers had written his book yet. And I had promised one of my advisors before I went to college that I would write about whatever I did. And so I decided I would just learn out in public. And as I learned something, I'd write about it and just held on.
Yeah, you told me why that it was interesting, but why you moved from the performance and dance to, because you didn't see so much.
Well, I saw a lot of traditional media, a lot of cued baked media, but I was most interested in the invisible world that we take for granted. That's all around us. It's the data that informs our everyday lives. It's our past selves that we walk past. It's the trajectories and vectors that we leave trailing in the world, and finding a way to make that invisible part of the world integrated and visible and responsive for performers, I thought was really what was exciting.
Natalie, a big part of your life is the teaching part, in a way. You're not only teaching, you support the community of touch design in an incredible way. Now you write on Facebook group, it's weird that you don't rap. Why you like it?
I like it. I love the act of teaching. I think that's really an incredible opportunity to communicate with people. But I also feel like I learned from really incredible people that were kind and generous with their time and knowledge. And I feel like the more that we, if we hoard our gold, if we keep all our knowledge secret, then it slows down how fast we can make changes and investigate new ideas. And so for me, like learning how to write a shader or learning the complexities of Python, that's not really the fun stuff. The fun, exciting stuff is what you do with that. So if there's ways to help people get past the really hard parts of understanding so they can experiment and explore and create, I think that's where we're all the happiest. So I feel like that's a really important thing to do. And I think it's also important to recognize that I've been very fortunate. I've had a lot of privilege around being able to go to graduate school and have access to all these incredible instructors and opportunities. But not everyone has that. And using something like the internet and making resources that are freely available broadens the audience for people that can experiment and explore and express themselves. And I think the world's a better place when there are more voices expressing ideas. It's like, I feel like it's like gardening, right? It's like you plant things not because you only want to have them for yourselves, but you end up with a big garden and you want to share it with people, and you want other people to garden, and you want a big flourishing world.
You worked for Obscura Digital. You are well known also for that.
So I wound up at Obscura because of Isabel, of course. I was getting towards the end of my graduate program and trying to figure out what I was going to do next. And Isabel said, you have to go talk to Barry Through at Obscura. And so I went out and interviewed with Barry, and then I came back and taught a workshop. And then before I knew it, I was on a plane to China to do a big installation. Like, I think the biggest event I'd done before that was 9 projectors. And then in China, it was 37 channels of video. And I was like, okay, this is a lot harder. And so it was interesting. Obscura always treaded that boundary of work that seemed impossible from the outside, but it was such a dedicated and committed group of people that no one ever imagined that this impossible thing couldn't be done. It's like, of course it's impossible, and of course we're going to do it, and it will be remarkable. And I think that was one of the pieces I loved about Obscura, was that it was a fearless group of people that were not interested in the technology. Like, the technology was our tool, but it was really about what's the art that we're creating, what's the message that we're crafting, how are we changing the world, hopefully for a better place, and in a beautiful way. And that was always inspiring to be a part of. You'll stay up late at night.
Did you grow in one side of the studio?
I think the side that I grew the most in was the analytical systems and kind of highly organized programming side of me. Because that was the space that I was the most intimidated by. And it was also the space that was the hardest, it was the hardest work. It's like, how do you build something that makes sure that you don't have to rebuild the whole thing every time? Because we lost so much of our opportunity for creative and expressive work building calibration systems and building distributed video systems. The gap that I saw there, not only in the work that we were doing, but also in myself, was really understanding that part of the problem really deeply, so that you had space to explore the art and creative and expressive side of the work. So it was investing in the kind of foundation, so there was an opportunity to do more interesting, expressive, dynamic, generative art.
And your personal stuff in these 4 years, where you was really present online and really present in location or mm-hmm. around the world, as you told me. But did you miss to produce something for yourself, for the world, but only by yourself?
Yes, I think that's looking back, it's always easier when you're like looking back over years. And I think looking back over the time, I think that's just the gap in my own practice, is that I've made lots of things for other people, but I haven't made very many things that were just for me. Right? Just my own little piece of artwork here or there. And I think that's important to recognize, and I think part of the direction I'm hoping to move next is carving out more space to make things that are for me, that are make things that are fun and interesting and beautiful. I want to make beautiful things. Don't necessarily have to have deep meaning or be, transform the world, but something that's just beautiful to watch.
To the new coder, no? The young guy that want to start, what are the first suggestions from Matthew Regge?
So I think about this from an art school or from a performance or a dance perspective, right? Is that it's your etudes, it's your scales, it's the practicing your fundamentals that have the biggest impact on what you can do later. You know, as a ballet dancer, it was always the hour that you spent at bar doing things that didn't seem particularly interesting, but built the discipline and the dedication for really thinking about how you were moving your body. Meant that once you're moving across the floor, you didn't have to think about those little pieces anymore. And so I think sometimes it's the little etudes, it's your scales, it's practicing little small things so you can do much bigger expressive work. I think the other important thing is to, every time I go to an art museum and I see someone with an easel copying a master's work, I think that's so important to do some copy art. find something that you think is beautiful or interesting and find a way to replicate it. Because you'll make it, but in that process, you'll learn something about the artist that you're observing. You'll learn something about yourself as an artist. You'll make something similar and it will then veer off course all of a sudden. And you'll start to find your own voice in that. I think sometimes we imagine that art is this struck by lightning inspiration and like it came to me in a dream and I just have to do it. But it's really about being patient and being present and showing up and doing the work. Well, I think it's like, it's also not a destination, right? Like we imagine like, oh, I'm gonna learn this thing and then I will be an excellent touch designer. You'll learn some things and then you'll get a little better and then you'll realize there are other things that you don't understand. You have to learn those. And like, it's an always uncovering, evolving, growing exercise. It doesn't have an end point. It's a journey that you're going on. I know there's a beautiful book called The Actor and the Target. And one of the descriptions there is that the performance is the top of the iceberg, but all of the work, that invisible work, is what's underneath the water that you can't see, that's supporting this little tiny bit that emerges. Anything that you use, right? Like whether it's Touch Designer or Cinema 4D or Houdini or After Effects or paint, right? Like those are the tools that are at the end of your fingertips. And I think we forget sometimes to cultivate the thing that's further back away from what's all the way out there at the end. So it's important to, you know, see sunsets and walk in the forest and find the pieces that are interesting and inspiring and move you deeply, and to draw from those so you can think about what will flow out of you.
You find the time to do that?
Not as much as I should. And I think it's tempting to be like, oh, well, I need to learn this thing about GLSL, or I need to learn more Python, or I need to learn this other program. And we're always thinking about the things that are at the end of our fingertips instead of what's feeding that, what's driving that. Well, dancers always say, if your feet hurt, you're probably not doing something with your feet. Look at the joint above it. You're doing something weird with your knees. If your knees hurt, it's something in your hip, right? The place where you're experiencing the tension or discomfort is one step removed from where the problem really is. So don't just look at the part that hurts. Look at the part that's behind what's hurting.
Something like add? Woohoo, all right.